Now, in this problem, we have an endothermic reversible reaction, and we are asked a couple of questions about it. The first one is more qualitative. The second one, we'll need to be a little bit more quantitative. I'm going to go ahead and set up some of the equations that we're going to need for the second part, just because it'll maybe help in answering more effectively part A. All right, and so we're given in this case that we have a CSTR reactor. That means that when we write our material balance for that reactor, then we'll write it in an algebraic format, and the format I'll choose for expressing this will be that the volume divided by the inlet molar flow rate of component A, which is our only reactant, is equal to the fractional conversion divided by the rate of consumption of component A. And then we're going to need to have some information on what this rate of consumption is. The problem statement tells us that the reaction is elementary and reversible. Because of this, we can write the rate of consumption of component A as being equal to a forward rate constant times the concentration of A squared. Because it's an elementary reaction, we raise the concentration to the power of the stoichiometric coefficient. We have a minus term where we have a 1 over equilibrium constant because it's reversible, so we have Kc that's given to us, times the concentration of B times the concentration of C. A quick check to see whether this is thermodynamically consistent is that at equilibrium, the rate should be equal to zero. And so if we set the rate equal to zero, we should get the equilibrium relationship between Kc and the reactants and products. And we won't do that here. We can answer part A. This problem asks, if the isothermal reactor temperature is decreased, will the required volume to achieve a conversion of 40% increase, decrease, or remain the same? If we decrease the temperature, that's going to have a couple of effects. It's going to decrease our forward rate constant. We expect that rate constant to have an Arrhenius dependence on temperature. So decreasing the temperature strongly decreases that rate constant. We're also given that the reaction is endothermic. And so if we decrease the temperature, that also decreases the equilibrium constant. Both of those factors tend to decrease the rate. So we can see that the rate is directly proportional to this forward rate constant. And so we'll be decreasing the rate through the Arrhenius dependence. And because we're subtracting this number, decreasing Kc increases this number that we're taking a negative of. All right, and so that will tend to decrease the net rate of reaction of A. And so the overall effect, if we lower the temperature, we're going to lower the rate of consumption of A. And this will ultimately decrease the conversion that we can achieve in a reactor of a fixed volume. All right, now part B is more quantitative, and we'll turn to that now. We'll use some of these same equations that we've already set up. But we're going to need some additional equations, and those equations are expressions for concentration as a function of conversion, so that we can cast our entire material balance equation here in terms of conversion to plug in the conversion of 40%. This is a liquid phase reaction, so we don't have to worry about changes in volumetric flow rate. And so therefore, we can very simply express the concentration of A in terms of an initial concentration times 1 minus x. We can write down the concentration of B. Since we're not feeding any B, it will be equal to the concentration of A times x divided by 2. And that's because for every mole of A that reacts, we produce half a mole of B. So we expect B to be at half the concentration of the A that was reacted. And the same is actually true for the concentration of C. Now we have enough information to substitute into the boxed equation here and cast that equation entirely in terms of conversion. And so we'll do that combining step here. When I plug all of that in, then I get the expression that's shown here. And then I can do a little bit more rearrangement. And I can plug in the value of 0.40 for the conversion and 1.7 for Kc. You see, I've brought over Kca naught terms from the denominator of the right-hand side to the numerator of the left-hand side, and I've expressed FA naught in terms of CA naught times the initial volumetric flow rate. And so I get this collection of terms. This collection of terms is known as a Domkohler number for this reaction. And it's a dimensionless quantity, and it turns out to be equal to 1.2. I've set up this problem for the initial case without really talking about part B. So initially we were given that we were feeding at a concentration of 1 mole per liter, component A, but we weren't feeding any of components B or C. And so that's the case that I used to set up part B initially. But now we want to consider the case where we're still not feeding any B, we're feeding A at the same amount. Now we're feeding component C at 0.5 mole per liter. We can take a quick look at how this is going to affect the problem that we just set up, which describes what the Domkohler number is for the original reactor. We still are going to be using the same form of the material balance because it's still a CSTR reactor. And so we'll use this equation. The rate expression is still exactly the same. We're going to expect that rate as a function of concentration to be the same. The equation for the concentration of A remains the same. And the equation for the concentration of B will remain the same because we're not feeding any B and we're still going to produce half as much B as A that we consume. And so what's going to change is the concentration of C because now we're feeding some C into the reaction mixture. And so we want to be able to account for that. We can write out our new expression for the concentration of C. The concentration of C is now equal to that concentration of C that we start with, the 0.5 mole per liter, plus CA naught times X over 2, because we produce 0.5 mole of C for every mole of A that we react. We can go ahead and express this. Now we can plug in for this concentration of C back in our original expression, right, that's up at the top here. So we can combine the rate expression with this equation and then plug in for the concentrations of A, B, and C that we've already expressed. When we do that, we'll get the following. I've gone ahead and plugged in the value of Kc as 1.7. The X we want to achieve is still 0.40. And you'll see if we compare to the expression that's shown above here, the development is very much the same. The only difference is in this final term. Instead of an X squared, we have an X times a 1 plus X. And this 1 is coming from the fact that we're feeding 0.5 mole per liter of C in with the reactant stream. We can plug in the value of 0.4 and solve for this Domkohler number. And note that I've provided a subscript 2 for this V2. So the volume of the reactor now is going to have to be different, and it will turn out it'll have to be greater because the Domkohler number is equal to 1.4. And so we see that the original value of the Domkohler number was equal to 1.2. And so therefore, the amount that we have to expand the volume by is equal to V2 over V. And all of these other parameters are the same according to the problem statement. So the reaction rate constant won't change because the temperature is fixed. We're still feeding the same total volumetric flow rate. We're just feeding a dilute amount of C along with it. And the inlet concentration of A is still fixed. And so the only thing that is changing in either of these expressions is the volume. And so when we divide this expression by this one, then those other terms cancel out and we get just V2 over V is equal to 1.4 over 1.2. And this is equal to approximately 1.2. So we'll need about a 20% larger reactor to still get 40% conversion when we feed some of the products. Again, if we go back to this rate expression, when we feed products, we're increasing that concentration of C because there's a negative sign in here that lowers the rate of consumption of A. And so we need a larger reactor to carry the reaction out to the same extent. This problem is another one of these examples where we are given information about how the reactor is performing initially. And so we set up material balances and solve for a dimensionless number for that case. And that allows us to consider this change, how this change affects the Domkohler number through a ratio of the Domkohler number in the second case compared to the Domkohler number in the first case.